Coming up in this special edition of VCU InSight, documentaries from students in VCU School of Mass Communications.
We'll see how the Rappahannock River is facing problems and what you can do about it.
Why exotic animals are getting special attention in the Commonwealth.
And how Richmond is getting the last laugh.
VCU InSight, the documentary edition, starts right now. Hello and welcome to this special documentary edition of VCU InSight. I'm Martha Bricky.
And I'm Amanda Dix. Thanks for joining us. It's a body of water that, for Virginians, means good food, good times, and a special connection.
But over the past few decades, the almost 200-mile Rappahannock River isn't as healthy as it used to be. Turns out, there's something almost everyone can do to help.
Because when it comes to the Commonwealth's rivers, no one wants to see dead water.
Well, I crabbed when I was a kid with my father, you know, 50 years ago. Oh, we could set, you know, two or three pots off the dock and catch enough to, for the family to feed on and eat for a weekend.
Well, when I grew up, we had what was called, or still is called, water view. And I could go to sleep at night and look out my window and see the Rappahannock and certainly different phases of the moon. I mean, it just sparkled. And the sun, it's like diamonds on the water. And it, you know, there's just something deep and satisfying and peaceful about the river.
Well, I think back to when I was a kid, really, which is when I was really crabbing a lot, and that was actually in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s, okay? And we used to spend our time in a little 12-foot boat, and we could go out and scrape pilings for crabs and come back with a bushel of nice jimmies in an hour and a half. And nowadays, you just don't see that happening. Well, the mission of Friends of the Rappahannock is to be the voice and the active force for a healthy and scenic Rappahannock River. And the reason we say voice is because the river doesn't have a voice of its own. Someone needs to speak for it.
I always like to say when I went to school and things that I lived on the healthiest river in the state of Virginia. But what I never knew until I worked for Friends of the Rappahannock is that it really isn't the healthiest river in the state of Virginia. We have the largest dead zone, which is caused by nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment.
The nitrogen is really, really bad because it creates those algae blooms. And so if there's too much algae in the river and in the bay, that's algae pollution. And then when it dies, it will create the dead zones where there's no oxygen. So it's not even just the blue crabs that can't survive because they don't have oxygen, but all of your shellfish on the bottom will suffocate, all of your plant life will suffocate, like nothing can live without oxygen.
Depleted oxygen winds up coming into that area. It could possibly drift over into an area where you're crabbing at. So there has been some problems. That pool pot has been dead as a doornail. I have a whole pot chock full of crabs and they're all dead.
We catch our most dead crabs in this area right here. And I don't know if it's because of the marina or the flow of the water, but for some reason, they don't live as well over here.
Nitrogen and phosphorus come from fertilizers, animal waste, human waste, wastewater treatment plants. It comes from a variety of sources, fertilizer being one of the biggest ones.
But what the scientists have shown us is that spring fertilization, while it kind of seems intuitive, plants are growing, time to give them fertilizer, it actually ends up with a lot of that fertilizer being washed away in spring rain. Yeah, the Chesapeake Club was really built for groups just like us. You know, they put together the resources for Save the Crabs and a lot of the PR material and did all the focus groups on the interesting, fun, quirky little ads that you see on the TV.
Spring rains carry excess fertilizer to our sewers and rivers. It travels to the Chesapeake Bay, where blue crabs have been rapidly disappearing. They suffocate slowly from lack of oxygen. No crab should die like this. They should perish in some hot, tasty, melted butter. So hold off on the fertilizer until fall, because ridding the planet of delicious backfin is just plain wrong.
The goal for the Save the Crabs program is to reduce the nutrient load. We use the blue crabs to get people's attention because, like I said, it's about the nutrient load. It's about the fertilizer. It's about the health of the river. But people aren't really going to care about it because it's out of sight, out of mind. But if you like to eat your blue crabs, that makes it more personal. And then they actually want to be involved in the campaign. And I think the slogan that the Chesapeake Bay Club created was great. Save the crabs and eat them. Because that really makes you think, and that makes people ask questions about it.
In the Northern Neck Peninsula, 90% of the farmers have nutrient management plans. And what I feel like a lot of people don't understand is that the farmer does everything that they can to save money, not waste fertilizers, and do what they need to do.
Many people don't understand that they typically think of farmers as plowing their land, and we just don't do that anymore. And they say the crab campaign is concerned about timing of fertilizer. I don't believe it applies to us. We do apply fertilizer in the fall. We just put down enough to get a crop established.
It starts at home. It starts with the homeowner. That is where the power is, with the people who don't even realize how big of an impact they're having on the river.
Living is about decision making and choices, and we all have those choices to make, and hopefully the choices like to just, if you do fertilize your lawn, to do it just in the fall, because people don't think as much in a city that their runoff is going to get into a river, but indeed their runoff gets into a river. It's like a domino. One thing affects, and then that's all crashing down. So we need to work on this together, all of us.
You know, we are by no means have the right to tell anybody what to do. It's something that a person needs to feel a connection to the river, to the crabs, really just to the population that we have and the economy that we have, and they need to take the pledge themselves to make a difference.
We got 243 pledges this year. And with each pledge, that keeps 3.5 pounds of fertilizer out of the river. This year, we kept out about 850 pounds of nitrogen and phosphorus.
I think it's an admirable goal because that symbolizes saving the crabs, symbolizes saving all the bay and all the fauna and life that lives in the water. And the river itself means so much to me.
It's about making that commitment to your grandchildren or your great-grandchildren that one day you want to see the crabs and you want to have the same experiences that you may have grown up with.
Overall, if we can get the crab population up and keep it up and bring it back, I would love to see it back to the levels that they were at when I was a kid.
Go! Go.
My goal, my personal goal would be that we have a healthier river and certainly a healthier bay and a healthier world. But I want us to be able to share this gift that we have, because I don't see that I really own this property. I see that it's just a gift and it's my time to have it.
Keep supporting the cause and try to keep everybody educated on what's happening out here in our water. Try to keep this water healthy and clean.
And according to the Chesapeake Club, putting down fertilizer in the fall just isn't good for Virginia's waters. It's better for your lawn.
Turns out more isn't better when it comes to fertilizer. Too much makes the roots weak, which in turn weakens your entire lawn.
Our next documentary from students in VCU's School of Mass Communications involves some furry friends you may not want in your home.
Almost everyone loves pets like dogs or cats, but what if the cat is a lion or a tiger?
The issue of people owning exotic animals has gotten a lot of attention lately. Some in the Commonwealth of Virginia want legislation to restrict their ownership. Others say it's not a problem.
It's turned into a battle of the wild.
Over the past several years, more and more exotic animals have become common in homes and backyards across the Commonwealth of Virginia. The regulations around exotic animal ownership have become a huge debate after the 2011 Zanesville, Ohio incident, where police were forced to kill 49 animals released by their owner. It's become a battle of the wild.
We're mostly concerned about the animals that are dangerous and could be a threat to humans, and that would include large cats, bears, lions, tigers, venomous and constricting snakes, and primates for the most part.
Laura Donahue has been working for the Humane Society for a year and a half. Its main goal pertaining to exotic animals is advancing animal protection through legislation.
We're also concerned about the threat to humans and to public safety with them being prevalent in our communities now.
Dr. Jim Lavender is the senior pastor at Discovery United Methodist Church in Richmond, Virginia. He has been involved with exotic animals since he was 5 years old. Lavender owns a variety of animals at his home, but his exotic animals are the ones he uses to help teach his sermons.
We adopt animals that don't have anywhere to go, usually from the entertainment world, and then I use them to teach Christian truths and biblical scriptures to boys and girls all over America. Hey, Baba. I really don't have a desire to own them. I have a desire to be their parent or to provide stewardship for them. And that really is my goal, to see that an animal that doesn't have anywhere to go or it has insufficient needs being met has all of those things taken care of for life.
Like Donahue, Dr. Lavender believes that exotic animals should not be kept as pets.
The current laws in the Commonwealth of Virginia are quite adequate, in my opinion. They do need to be enforced. We need to be sure that we don't have animals in homes where they should not be, but in the hands of someone who is a professional or who has a business that is prepared to take care of them, but they should not be pets.
Snakes are an exotic animal that some people question as pets.
I do not believe that we should have giant constricting snakes kept in glass containers in homes. I believe that they should be in welded steel if we're going to have them.
Victoria Fico is a current VCU student. She has two ball pythons living in her home as her pets.
They're like my little children. I love them to death. I try to get them out of the cage as often as possible because, you know, in the tank they can't really move around as much, so I try to get them exercise at least once a week. I would say that I'm pretty close with them. They like to be very active, and they're very friendly.
Although these snakes may seem friendly, they are classified as constrictors, and without careful handling, they have the potential to be dangerous.
Both of them have actually bitten my father, but that's because it was right after feeding and his hand smelled like a rodent.
Surprisingly, these snakes, among other exotic animals, are easily obtained. In Chesterfield County, a local pet expo had a number of exotic animals for sale.
That thing's heavy.
Yeah, it is.
Been down it so far.
Pythons, lizards, tarantulas, and much more can be sold to anyone at the Pet Expo, starting at just $20.
What we do here is no different than a gun show, craft fair, baseball card show, memorabilia, is the same stuff. Just different stuff on the table.
Another kind of exotic animal is a hybrid cat. A Bengal cat is a type of hybrid that is mixed with an Asian leopard and a domestic cat. Jillian Ledford has a Bengal cat named Spartacus. Ledford fosters animals through the Richmond SPCA, and along with Spartacus has four other pets.
Their whole front has their stripes and stuff, and it goes all the way down to their belly. And they're the only cats that actually have stripes on their stomach. And at the very bottom of their stomach, they do have some spots.
Spartacus is 10 weeks old and is Ledford's first exotic animal.
I do not have a permit for Spartacus. Actually, I'm not entirely sure if he's required to have a permit or not. I haven't really looked into it yet. I was waiting until he gets bigger. And if somebody says something, then I'll probably look into it.
Exotic animal experts say that the problem is people don't know the current exotic animal laws, making it almost impossible for them to abide by them.
We worked with Delegate Chris Pease in this past legislative session to introduce legislation that would restrict the ownership of certain exotic species, the dangerous ones, essentially the ones that can kill us, to only licensed and accredited facilities.
The AZA is the American Association of Zoological Parks and Aquariums, and they hate people like me.
It would be our preference that only facilities accredited by the AZA own these certain exotic and dangerous animals. And that is because the AZA is the gold standard.
And you can't force somebody, like it's like me trying to force you guys to join the United Methodist Church. How insane could it be? Congress right now wants AZA to regulate everything and put Humane Society volunteers in charge of enforcing it, which means some animal rights fanatic can carry a badge, take your animals, put you in jail, and make you pay for them confiscating your animals for no reason. That's where we are right now.
The issue on what restrictions should be placed on exotic animal ownership is still ongoing. In 2013, the legislation will be reintroduced to the Virginia General Assembly with hopes there will be a compromise on exotic animal regulations.
As we just heard, part of the conversation about exotic animals in the Commonwealth involves the Association of Zoos and Aquariums.
Wherever you fall in this discussion, the AZA website has some really interesting manuals on caring for these kinds of animals.
And different animals, too. Try instructions for how to take care of an Andean condor, an indigo snake, and even a polar bear.
And finally tonight, RVA gets the laugh.
Stand-up comedy has been an American entertainment mainstay since the days of Jack Benny and George Burns.
Its history isn't as long in Richmond, but a dedicated group of comedians want to make the city a capital for laughs.
It's no joke. It's Comedy Richmond, VA.
Hey, I used to have a unibrow, but now I shave it in the middle, because if I don't, my face looks like an equal sign. That one mustache plus one unibrow does not equal Nick getting laid. It equals Nick home alone in the dark, rubbing one out and crying himself to sleep. That's real talk.
Really happy that any night of the week in Richmond you can do comedy somewhere. You can get on stage somewhere or watch a show. That is a sense of pride for me that I am very, very grateful that we have that here.
And only in the year that I've been doing it, it's really grown a lot. There used to be very few shows around town. Now there's a show every week.
I mean, this stuff was not happening 3 or 4 years ago. Like, there was nothing here.
The scene in Richmond was, I've heard of the Funny Bone before, some stuff like that. Other small places like McCormick's, I think, does it once a week. As far as I know, that was pretty much it. I had no idea that there was, you know, stuff on just about every night.
The scene in Richmond has really become something spectacular and wonderful that it's, not to get all mushy or anything, but it just makes me so happy that we're at this point now.
Richmond comedy is an interesting beast because there's two kind of stand-ups in town. There's like the old guard who started doing stand-up in like the 80s.
They're serving, they have a chocolate film with cotton candy. It shouldn't be called Golden Crowd, it should be called Type 2. That's what it is.
And then there is like the new kind of comedian that's like based on trying to be as honest as possible. And like, I guess we come off as more hip because of that, because we try to be very, what's the word I'm looking for? Genuine, I guess.
Imagine, if you will, Buddy gets the ball. You just see like this 250-pound fifth grader just, it's me, tackles him, body slams him on the ground.
There are a lot of really great stand-ups in Richmond. There's a lot of really great kids just starting out, and I think we have the benefit of VCU and a couple of occasions U of R being so close that there's so many people from different backgrounds that are coming out and trying new things that otherwise they wouldn't try.
I recently came across a bunch of dolphins. My friends are asking me, they're like, what are you gonna do? Are you gonna sell them to the zoo or release them to the wild or something? Figure it. I'll just keep them for my own porpoises.
Raymond Bullock. I've been doing comedy professionally since 1995. I've been running a stand-up comedy room here in Richmond since February of 1999.
I'm a fat man, I'm proud to be fat. But I'm also an American. So when I see someone who is fatter than me, I judge them. That's how that happens.
The scene, I'd say, in the last 3 years here in Richmond has really exploded when Betsy Heckman, who started 955 Club with me all those years ago, when we first started, it was us. That was literally it. We were booked for a two-hour show, and we maybe had 4 minutes apiece, so it was literally the first show was, and now coming back up to the stage again, you know, type of situation.
My friend was like, hey, my landlord's kicking me out of my house. I know you're not living in your apartment much. Can I crash at your place? And then before I could answer, he's like, wait, I'm not gonna have sex on your bed. And I just kind of look at him and go, you know what? I got my parents' hand-me-down bed. I don't care.
I've been doing stand-up since mid-April. I had a podcast here at VCU since the start of freshman year, so that was 2 years ago. And then, you know, like everyone else in the world likes to tell jokes growing up, so that was basically, so there's a lot more people than I'm aware of in the comedy scene, because basically it's like, what venue do you know type thing, and that's where you perform, and I go to Pi a lot.
That's one of the best parts of Pi, is we're right there on the campus, so people don't feel threatened or like they have to go out of their comfort zone to come to us. We've had people come by before who just stop and get on stage because I asked them to. And they try there and then they keep coming back. So.
I've been doing comedy about 2.5 years. Kind of just started hitting open mics, but after I got dumped by a girlfriend, I was kind of like, you know, I'm gonna just do this full, like, just as much as I can. There's no reason not to now. Like, there's nothing holding me back.
The whole Fast and the Furious controversy recently, the controversy wasn't that they made 5 movies, but
I think it's important for new comics to remind themselves of, is just like, okay, you have to start somewhere. You don't start off just like, oh yeah, awesome, I'm gonna open up for, you know, Daniel Tosh or something. And, you know, it's just like, no, you have to pay your dues, you have to make your mistakes, you have to bomb a lot, you have to bomb a lot.
I'm doing this thing, right? I'm like, wow, okay, above average, that's cool. Because for my grades, I'm below average, which is kind of weird for an Asian guy. My parents don't really talk to me at the reunion. It's weird.
I think Richmond's only going to become a better scene over time. There's no way that's not going to happen as far as I'm concerned.
I think because it's such a strong community base here, and because we're all really looking out for each other, it's going to get even bigger. It's going to get even bigger.
Went on a date with a woman, and at the end of the night, I ended up with a strand of her hair, right? And I kept it because I'm creepy.
I think we're on the cusp of becoming something very good.
But I said, all right, I'm going to put a love spell on this hair so she falls in love with me, right?
In the next 5 years, my hope is that Richmond is known as a stand-up comedy town.
But I'm glad I did it, because it was weave. And I'm thinking, all right, what if I put this spell on it, right? And then, like, I'm driving down the road, and, like, this is horses just following me. It's like madly in love with me, you know?
And comedy just isn't good for a night out. Experts point out that all that laughing strengthens our immune systems, gives us more energy, and reduces stress, which, as a student, I would love.
Yes, and I can appreciate it as well. And that's going to do it for the special documentary edition of VCU InSight.
Make sure to check us out online at insight.vcu.edu. I'm Martha Bricky.
And I'm Amanda Dix. For all of us at VCU InSight, good night.